Welcome to Broadmoor Community Church, a church that believes so strongly, no matter who you are or where you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. You are welcome to God's embrace. You are welcome to all the love that God's children deserve and get. I am Reverend Ann Cubbage, and it is my honor and privilege to be the senior pastor at this place. And as we go into worship this day, I hope that you have been able to think about your journey on the Holy Way and to consider how it is that you are allowing God to lead you and guide you. As we go into this time, I did want to remind you that there are slides at the end of the worship service that will let you know how you can give of your finances. Thank you so much for the ways that you have continued to support the ministries of this church. They also will let you know of the different ways that you can join in prayer, join in small groups, or if you are interested, whenever you are in town, if you would like to come by 315 Lake Avenue, I would love to get to know you. We worship at 10 a.m. on Sunday mornings. There is Sunday school during worship, except for first Sundays, where children and adults worship together. Let me spit that out. We also have a nursery at all times. There are several activities that are happening, and one of those is a concert that is coming up, Soli Deo. You can get more information on the last page, as I said, on those slides. If you are a person who needs prayer, if you are a person that believes strongly in prayer, please contact me, acubbage@broadmoorchurch.org. And if you have any comments or concerns, feel free to contact me on that same email. It is a pleasure to be in ministry with and for you. God bless all of you. And let us now take in a deep breath and let it out, knowing that God is with you always and everywhere as you travel the Holy Way. Let us worship God. And now, as we go into worship, I invite you to hear these words written in Proverbs. Trust in God with all your heart. Let us not rely on our own insight. In all your ways, acknowledge God, and God will make straight our paths. Let us worship. Hi everyone, it's Ms. Liz. How are you today? It is so good to see you as always. Thanks for watching. Like I said last week, I know that some of you watching are probably watching from far away. You don't live anywhere close to Colorado Springs. And isn't it wonderful that we have this way to connect? But I bet some of you watching live quite close to me. That you live quite close to our church here in Colorado Springs. And if you do, I just want you to know you are welcome here anytime. You are welcome to come and meet me and meet Pastor Ann. We have Sunday school at 10 a.m. on Sunday mornings if you would like to join us. We'd love to see you. So, my friends, this week we are talking about storms. What do you think about storms? How do they make you feel? Sometimes I think they're quite exciting. I think it's wonderful to see
the sky flash with big, bright flashes of lightning. Sometimes I love to hear the rumble of thunder as it shakes the house, shakes things around me. Other times, I find storms quite scary. Sometimes the lightning is too much or too close, and the thunder is just too loud and shakes my house so much that I feel kind of scared inside. How about you? Well, storms can make us feel lots and lots of different things. Storms also show us sort of how mysterious and powerful God is. They remind us that God is really stronger than anything. And also, my friends, I want you to know that in those storms, God is near you. Yes, even when those storms are scary, God is very, very close to you. So, the next time you're in a storm, if you think it's exciting and wonderful and just fabulous, maybe say a quick prayer and give God thanks for God's awesomeness and God's power. If you're in a storm and you're finding that storm kind of scary, I want you to remember that God is very close to you. And maybe you can say a quick prayer and ask God that God would show you their presence and how close they are to you and bring you peace. Let's say a prayer. You can repeat after me, okay? Dear God, thank you for your love. When I see storms, help me to remember how powerful and wonderful you are. And help me to remember that you are close by, that you are near me, even when I am afraid. Thank you, God. We love you. Amen. Okay, my friends, I hope you have a great week, and I'll see you again soon.
The scripture reading today is from Mark chapter 9, verses 17 and following. A man out of the crowd answered, "Teacher, I brought my mute son, made speechless by a demon, to you. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, grinds his teeth, and goes stiff as a board. I told your disciples, hoping they could deliver him, but they couldn't." Jesus said, "What a generation! No sense of God. How many times do I have to go over these things? How much longer do I have to put up with this? Bring the boy here." They brought him. When the demon saw Jesus, it threw the boy into a seizure, causing him to writhe on the ground and foam at the mouth. He asked the boy's father, "How long has this been going on?" "Ever since he was a little boy. Many times it pitches him into fire or the river to do away with him. If you can do anything, do it. Have a heart and help us." Jesus said, "If?" There are no ifs among believers. Anything can happen. No sooner were the words out of his mouth than the father cried, "I believe. Help me with my doubts." I believe. Help my unbelief. You know, this plea of a desperate father expresses a profound, difficult, confusing, and common experience. All followers of Jesus have both belief and unbelief, both faith and doubt, present in us at the same time. So how can we possibly walk the holy way? We see this contradiction present in other passages. Consider Peter, who walked on water only to start sinking when doubt set in. Even so, I totally believe that Peter was on the holy way. We see it through the Psalms, where folks wrestle with their disbelief, and we see it all too frequently in ourselves, which is why we identify with the desperate Father's plea. Disbelief is a temptation for all believers. Though it is a common temptation, it is a spiritually dangerous one, one that can lead us to miss out on a whole and wholesome relationship on our journey with God. Each of us has unique experiences and distinct temperaments that make us vulnerable to disbelief, and it is something Jesus is happy to help us with if we but ask him, as did this desperate father. We can certainly understand why the father of this poor boy was vulnerable to disbelief. Just imagine what his experiences had been up to the point when he encountered Jesus. He had spent a number of years, I'm sure, doing everything he could in order to help his son. The terrible condition had tormented the boy since early childhood, causing violent seizures and preventing him from speaking. The father, and no doubt his wife, had saved their precious child from death numerous times, rescuing him out of both fire and water. They lived with the daily fear that they might not be there in time to save him the next time. They lived with the future fear of what would become of him when one or both were no longer there to save him. They also, very likely, lived with a deep fatigue brought on by almost constant vigilance night and day. They may have endured a continual strain on their marriage that often accompanies stressful and painful parenting situations. Don't you suppose they probably lived from one paycheck to the next due to the numerous ways their son's condition affected them financially, from the direct costs of seeking out help for him to the indirect costs of having less time devoted to earning a living? And on top of all of that, they probably lived with the shame that perhaps they had somehow sinned and brought this curse upon their boy, a shame compounded by knowing that others wondered the same thing. Surely, this beleaguered father had prayed often for his son, but with no visible results. Certainly, he had previously sought out other spiritual leaders or exorcists to bring healing, to no avail. Hearing stories of Jesus' power over disease stirred in him enough hope that he brought his child to see Jesus. Not finding the famous rabbi, he pleaded with Jesus' disciples for help, but they were no more effective than anyone else had been. We can understand why his hope, and therefore his faith, seemed to be ebbing low when Jesus showed up. This father was very much like us. His disbelief had roots in his experiences. So does ours. His fears and disappointment shaped his expectations. So do ours. He was vulnerable to losing the fight for faith. So are we. We can sympathize with this man when he pleaded with Jesus, "If you can do anything, have compassion on us, help us," because we probably prayed or thought similar things. Jesus' response to this father catches us off guard. "If you can, all things are possible for one who believes." This shocks us. And the reason is because we expect Jesus to comfort this man. Instead, he rebukes him. It makes us wonder, is this how Jesus feels about our disbelief? Will a rebuke to us keep us off the holy way? Let's look a bit more closely. The father of this boy had said to Jesus, "If you can do anything." There is faith in this request. Faith is why he sought Jesus out in the first place. But there's also disbelief. Part of him does not expect Jesus will be any more successful than others had been, and Jesus saw this disbelief as a slap in the face of the Almighty, hence the rebuke. Faith is the channel through which God's grace and spiritual gifts flow. Disbelief obstructs the channel and therefore inhibits the flow of God's grace. Jesus does not coddle doubt, just like a good doctor doesn't coddle cancer in a patient. If left invisible and untreated, doubt will separate this man even further from God. Hence the rebuke. And it worked. We hear this in the Father's desperate cry, "I believe, help my unbelief." Jesus heard and honored the Father's faith, however defective. This man's disbelief did not disqualify him from traveling the holy way. All of us hold some disbelief. Disbelief can block the channels of faith. It can rob you of joy, and if not dealt with, it can destroy you. But the presence of disbelief in us is often subtle. We don't always see it clearly. It has roots in our experiences and personalities. In a small Texas town, so the story goes, a bar began construction on a new building. The local Baptist church started a prayer campaign to block the bar from opening. Work progressed right up till the week before opening, when lightning struck the bar and it burned to the ground. The church folks were smug after that, until the bar owner sued the church on the grounds that the church was ultimately responsible for the demise of his building. The church vehemently denied all responsibility or any connection to the building's demise in its reply to the court. The judge looked over his paperwork. At the hearing, he commented, "I don't know how I'm going to decide this case. It appears that we have a bar owner who believes in the power of prayer and an entire congregation that does not." Our doubt, skepticism, self-pity, and self-indulgence can seem to us understandable, even justifiable. But what we really need, even though we might prefer to avoid it, is for Jesus to help us see our unbelief. Two of the greatest people of faith were Abraham and Sarah. When everything was hopeless, Abraham believed anyway, deciding to live not on the basis of what he saw, he couldn't do, but on what God said he would do. That said, we also know that Abraham had his own periods of disbelief. He didn't think his postmenopausal wife would be able to bear a child, so he arranged a surrogate, Hagar. And God had to correct his thinking. He feared for his life when he entered a foreign land, so Abraham passed his wife off as his sister and gifted her to the king's harem. And God corrected him. And there was Sarah, listening at the tent door, who fell on her face laughing when the strangers at Mamre gave voice to God's promise that she would bear a son. We all have our periods of disbelief, but don't you want that channel of God's grace to be wide open, unclogged? Don't you want to walk the holy way in step with God's Spirit? If so, it's time to say with the man in the gospel reading, "I believe, help my unbelief."
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
I would invite you at this time to a bit of silence as we pray to God for our joys and our concerns. I will then follow with prayers of the people, and together I hope you will join with me in the prayer that is given to us by Jesus the Christ to his disciples. The words will be on your screen. Let us pray. Holy, 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 God of power and might, you alone are the one that guides us and directs us, who embraces us and loves us. Help us to recognize that we are truly your beloved children. As we come to you this day, we find ourselves on the holy way, and so often we have fallen off and moved because of detours, things that have taken our attention away from us, things that have caused us doubt. God, give us the grace, the courage to believe in you regardless of our situations. It is hard, God, when we hear about young people getting shot at school, when we hear about so many dying in Gaza, when we hear about the troubles in Ukraine brought on by Russia's war, when we hear about the starving people in Sudan and so many other places, God, it just feels like you aren't here, like you don't care, and yet we know that you do. Give us the strength to recognize that even when we walk through the deepest, darkest valleys, you are with us. We pray these things this day in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
It is the cry of my heart to follow you. It is the cry of my heart.
As we go from this place, as we take our journey with God along the holy way, may you be filled with God's Spirit, God's courage, God's strength. May you have a faith that is wide open, and may you recognize that it truly is the cry of our hearts to follow Christ. Go in peace. Amen.